we have conceptual designers that are working on conceptual artwork. Weta will do a whole other round of research and development and come up with a whole bunch of new suggestions just to make sure that that's the best and make sure that contributes to most of the story, because they know the apes better than anybody. I mean, they live and breathe with those guys, so they know what'll look cool on them when they move. They know what will work in the render, in the lighting environments and so on. So they'll bring all that to the table to make sure that it is the best it can be. And they're like that in every single detail of the movie.
I like working with Weta specifically because they love movies. I knew that they had a love for the title. And it really kicked off their mentality, their thinking about visual effects. Those Planet of the Apes ape suits, the prosthetics, made them want to do something in the computer. And there's nothing better than to have partners who love the story and love the franchise and love the underlying material.
The whole backbone of our methodology on how to make this movie successful is that you put a great actor into the role and then you just transfer their performance directly onto the CG model. And that's where the success lies.
Bang! And cut.
What's wonderful about performance capture technology is that it improves with every movie. The envelope's always being pushed, different solutions are needed for the art and craft, making it more of a transparent technology, so you're not aware of it. Obviously, shooting on these locations was a huge challenge because there were extreme weather conditions. In Vancouver, we had tons of very, very heavy rainfall, and we're wearing a lot of electrical equipment. But of course, the guys at Weta have done yet again sort of an extraordinary job of making new wiring systems, for instance, that are totally armored. Head-mounted cameras that are able to perform well in very adverse weather conditions. It's in a different league to what it was even 3 years ago on Rise of the Planet of the Apes. And that's an extraordinary thing to behold. And as an actor watching your performance that you've authored come through and seeing it exactly the same through the digital mask is such a testament to Weta.
We worked quite closely with Matt on two fronts. One was to evolve the characters that we know from the first film, just to show how they might have grown a little bit, how they might have aged, slightly more humanizing some of them. And then the next generation of characters are actually a little bit more humanized, if you will, to begin with. And so we make that distinction between the older generation and the new generation. And the reason that comes into play is obviously they're a lot more expressive. They have more to say than they did in the first film.
The thing that happened between Rise and our film is that Weta has taken a quantum leap forward in terms of the realism, the hair simulation, the skin simulation, the moisture simulation. Everything that they do in terms of the actual apes' bodies is so much more realistic that you're suddenly looking at something that both seems insanely real, but also is a complete mystery because there's human emotion that's being expressed through that photoreal ape.
Show.
We were able just to bring cameras in really quickly, and our turnaround time and setup time on set was drastically shorter, which allowed us to capture a lot more performance than we did on the last movie. Our entire pipeline went through a big sort of rehaul, and that made it much easier to deal with huge amounts of data. We actually custom built a new camera for this movie, which is the next generation of the camera we're using on a stage. Normally, it's optimized for what we do. We built new housings for the cameras, no lights, no exposed parts, again, to be able to protect them from the rain. I think we had altogether close to 100 cameras, or probably actually more with the mock-up stage.
There are two supervisors on this film, animation supervisor, Paul Story and myself. We supervise motion, and that could be anything from directing motion capture shoots to animating, or working with a team of animators who are animating a crane falling down. It covers the full range. Obviously, one of the biggest tasks in this film is the facial animation. So many shots, so many wonderful performances that we are determined to get out looking right.
Kill Caesar! Now take him with fire!
Our job is to pretty much recreate this character's performance. We pretty much copy the live performance of the character as much as possible.
It's human.
For the sequel, we pretty much added a whole bunch of new controls, readjusted existing facial shapes, just so it would work well with dialogue. Before we even start with the facial, we have to get the actual motion captured data of the body so that we can work off that. So body comes first and then the facial performance comes afterwards.
We'll start from the photography when we're on set. We'll set up our performance capture equipment and we'll put the actor in the suit and we'll have them go and participate in the scene just like any other actor would. We've got these dots on their bodies and these cameras on their faces, and they're recording all the movement that their body and their face is doing as they're going through the scene.
When Andy performs, we use the motion capture cameras to track everything. And what we'll then do is track those back onto a figure of Andy. And that's done just as an accuracy test. We want to make sure that we are really seeing what he did and performing that. So then the next step is to translate that to Caesar's performance. And we have to go through a process of really adjusting the different proportions of the character, you know, the limbs and the body length and so forth. We go through a similar evolution with the face.
It's all about subtleties. You can see here, for example, Andy's not moving much, but you can see that his anger is building. So we have to find ways to add that onto the CG character, onto the puppet. So all that intensity, all that subtlety of the performer goes into the CG character. All our controls are based on anatomy. So you're not making Caesar smile, you're making him move the muscles that trigger the smile.
We've aged him a little bit from the first film. He's got a little bit more gray in his hair. Some of the wrinkles are a little bit deeper. But one of the things that we changed more subtly was we made a few more tweaks to his facial geometry and his facial rig to more closely match Andy Serkis and try to get more of the nuances of Andy's performance.
Ready!
When I came on, I actually said to Weta, I said, you know, there are places here, whether it's the sort of pink under his eye right there that makes him look so sad, everything that Andy was doing, I was like, can we make sure that we get every single bit of that detail and somehow put that into Caesar's face? Because the challenge is that the shapes of our faces are different. So the anatomy of Caesar isn't exactly the anatomy of what Andy's face is. So how do you get that expressiveness and still put it into a face that isn't Andy's?
The biggest challenge for Caesar still probably is just trying to capture the emotion of Andy. The director's looking at Andy so often, he's seeing so many different things and different aspects of the emotion that we might not be seeing.
Well, that moment I do think is, I mean, I think when you come out, I think it is dead silence.
It's really just trying to capture Andy and these aspects of our puppet that actually are almost identical to Andy as far as the way the folds over the eyes are larger than a lot of characters we sort of see, and just the way that the eyelid folds underneath that. Yeah, just articulation with the mouth and just default poses Andy has. That's something that we really try and capture there.
We scoured through, you know, every kind of documentary and reference photographs from zoos, and we studied real apes that had some of the facial characteristics that we were looking for in our actors. And then we did make a few adjustments to their specific eyebrows and some of the folds in their eyes to better match the actors that were playing them.
You see what they're grabbing from Toby's face, from Andy's face, from the other actors' faces. Like Terry Notary, who plays Rocket, you can see when he's doing certain things. And that's the amazing magic of what Weta is doing, is finding the way in which they can take the parts of the actors and the parts of the apes and meld them in such a way that that emotion comes through.
Caesar!
Now, in the process of getting the movement just right, there's a lot of careful artistry and adjustment that has to happen in order to help the technical processes better match the actual artistic performance. As good as our technology is, it requires a human eye and a human hand to adjust and fit the nuances of what the actor was doing. Everybody loved the design of Koba and thought he was a great character, this kind of slightly twisted and damaged ape who now is released from the confines of human oppression. The thing that was fantastic about Toby's performance was just his sort of seething, vicious, evil faces that he would make. You really felt the malice. And then he was able to just suddenly transform completely, and every kind of sense of that kind of evil was gone, and he became this other kind of pitiable, innocent-looking ape.
Trying to get home? Go on! Get out of here, stupid monkey!
Oh, you heard him! Go!
Go!
Go
on!
And it's all driven by Toby. Yeah, he's just great.
Give him some nasty wabbits.
There we go. Whoa, hey.
Whoa,
okay,
hey.
Okay.
That's a fantastic scene, and it's a turning point for Koba, as it is for the whole story. And I think what really makes it work is that you can see how Koba has really gotten the confidence of these guys. He had this plan in his mind, and that's when you understand how intelligent he is and how dangerous he is.
It's yet another one of the scenes in this film that Matt's given us that is just a dream to work on, because it's the entire shot is nothing but three guys in a room. It's just that one of the guys is an ape. But it's kind of a combination of the best of the techniques. You know, sometimes it was a clean plate that the guys were acting against. Most of the time, in fact, it was Toby there with them. So you really get the three of them playing off of each other really effectively. So again, performance capture just really shines.
For our younger characters, we made a few adjustments. I mean, to start with, they don't have as much gray in their fur. In the case of Caesar's son, his coat's a little thicker than some of the older apes. Ash is a little different. Ash is the son of Rocket, and Rocket's kind of one of our barer, kind of more kind of grayed out apes. And so Ash, as his son, to kind of keep that resemblance, he's also a little kind of balder overall. And then we've also cast younger actors to play those apes. So their movements and their decisions kind of come from that grounding of just being a little younger and kind of more spry and youthful. The baby was based on a lot of baby chimps that we studied. The challenge with babies is that you can't really put them in a suit and performance capture them. So a lot of times we'll just cut the scene together with reference clips and sort of build a performance that way, and then go back in and keyframe animate that stuff. One of the most challenging things to do was to make an ape that looked feminine, and for chimpanzees that can be tough. But Matt was really kind of adamant that Caesar's wife needed to feel like a queen. And so we basically looked at the sexiest chimps we could find. We ended up with something that Matt was mostly happy with, but he still wanted to get some kind of longer hair and to just soften her features a little bit. So that's probably one of the biggest design deviations from the real world, is getting Cornelia to look more feminine.
It came down to quite a few rounds of design iterations, and we tried all kinds of ideas, and I think at the end it came down to a combination of balancing her body, but also small things like the angle of her eyes, the longer lashes, that really pushed in the right direction.
It's really hard to get fur to look like realistic fur to begin with, but then to add more elements of having it, you know, clumped together as it gets wet. They struggled with that, but they finally nailed it. Some of the reference that we were able to get was because we have such a close relationship with the Wellington Zoo, they'd give us a call and say, hey, do you guys want to come down and check out the chimp? What I was able to do one of the times was see just how the water reacts and how it rolls off the fur.
All the characters got completely regroomed. In the second movie, we see them like living in the open for like 15 years, so we have to show the realistic fur in all the states. Like we got dry fur, we got wet fur, we got damp fur, we have raindrops, dynamic raindrops in the fur. We even got war paint grooms that have like paint chips stuck to the individual hair. Caesar's groom is probably around 1 million single hairs. The average chimp is around 1 million hairs.
And so now we're able to take into account what we call dual scattering, the way that light actually behaves as it goes through hair. Considering the fact that there are so many more apes in this movie, it was a big concern. You know, we've got dozens and dozens of shots that have more than 800 apes in them, so it was a very busy time. The other aspect that has kind of crept in, and it doesn't turn up in many places in the film, but it certainly opens the film. We see the apes hunting, and everybody's wearing war paint. And then we see them again when they go to show strength, and they're wearing war paint. So that was an entire, another design process that we had to go through of, you know, what do apes come up with as war paint schemes for themselves? What does that look like? So the paint on the fur is yet another element that increased the complexity of what we have to deliver on this movie.
It makes sense, just given where they are in their evolution, that they would be riding horses as humans did, you know, for thousands of years as a prime way of getting around. And so we really thought that was important to show. And that was the actors riding horses, and then us replacing the actors, and in some cases the horses as well, just to get that sense of, okay, now these apes have evolved to the point where they actually can care for and ride horses, and you can see that as a symbol of a civilization developing.
So the plan for those was to shoot the plates with horses in them and riders on the horses, make sure we get a clean plate so that we can remove the riders. But in a lot of the shots in this movie, you have multiple horses in frame, you have multiple apes, and sometimes you just realize that the task was gonna be far too difficult to try and paint out the rider. So in those cases, you just say, all right, we're gonna have to render CG horses for this. We've had shots already where people couldn't tell which was real and which was in the plate, so that's great.
People wouldn't even realize the amount of work that happens on this shot. Even just having one person rotoscope the horses, they're tracing around these horses frame by frame, have to get the movement exactly right, pixel perfect. There can't be any lines out here. It has to be exactly to the horse, and you have motion blur and everything like that that needs to come into account. So that person probably take a couple of weeks, and then this other artist did the reflections, and that itself would take maybe a week. And when you think that this shot is only 100 frames, it's a couple of seconds pretty much.
How do you translate this giant grizzly bear from the page onto screen, and how do apes look when they're fighting these things? This is all the kind of stuff to start exploring in the previous stage, so that when you turn up in Vancouver and you head out in the woods and it's pouring rain, you know kind of what you need to shoot.
We didn't have anything in there that they were hunting. We knew we would put that in later. But then the grizzly bear, because that's a key moment of confrontation, we did have someone there with a stand-in just with a grizzly bear head, so the actors all knew what the position was and basically what to play off of. And then they mimed all that, because again, that performance really has nothing to do with the grizzly bear. That performance is all about Koba and Caesar.
One of the things I talked about with Weta was, how can they take this technology and put it in natural light, in real locations, in weather, in rain, and see how these models hold up under those conditions? Because my feeling was, if you could take those photorealistic apes and put them in a place that was utterly real, would that increase the illusion? First of all, they were thrilled at the idea, and they said, absolutely, that will happen. If we take them and we keep track of all the light, the way it's reflected in the woods, and then put that onto these models of the apes, when you take those images and put them together, it will seem 10 times more real. And so that's exactly what we did.
There's a lot of work going on to kind of fill in the environment of the story. Some of it you'll see in the forest. A lot of that was locations, but some pieces of it had to be, you know, extended. Like the dam had to be created as CG water. But a lot of what you see in the later scenes, especially in the human battle in San Francisco, had to be extended, because a lot of that was shot on stages or different locations and extended to be part of San Francisco. Of course, the Golden Gate Bridge, again, is a digital creation, as it was in the first film, but we had to age it and make it more decrepit and overgrown.
We shot a lot of photography in San Francisco. Mostly, we shot a lot of aerial photography, and we shot a lot of kind of city street plate photography. But San Francisco is a city where, you know, you can't really shut the city down and dress the buildings up in ivy and plants and dirt. You sort of have to shoot what you shoot and then go back and clean it up. So we did a lot of traffic removal and degradation of the buildings and the returning of the sort of plant life to the streets and that as well.
The Apes Village was a massive physical set, so a lot of what you see in there is constructed, beautifully done with all the sort of spiral shaped and interweaving timbers. But we did have to extend that sometimes just to show the elevation and to show all the surrounding hills and the rest of the village extending around it and the landscape that it's in. We were all fans of the original films, and we loved the old, you know, makeup and the idea of the chimps actually being portrayed by humans. But, you know, when we came to these stories, you really realized that what we needed here was the absolute believability of chimps evolving from what we know chimps to be today into this more intelligent form, both through things that you can see, like their posture slowly changing, and through their vocalizations beginning to emerge.
Do not come.
We focused on Caesar the last time around. Now it's always about the colony. It's always about the dynamics of Caesar and the other apes. And so a lot of the scenes are just hugely populated with apes, because you're always watching them responding to Caesar. And so this one really plays in broader scope.
the original Planet of the Apes has a special place in filmmaking history. And so I think the legacy is very much alive in the minds of the team that's working on those films today. And we're thrilled that we're able to be a part of it. And we feel really lucky to be able to bring characters to the franchise with our modern technology. It's a really great thing to be part of.